Good morning, everybody, or whenever time of day it is that you might look in. And I hope you'll stay with us because we've got, I say that every week, don't I? Well, I would. But thanks for looking in. May the Lord really bless you and knowing that we are loved, we're accepted in the Lord Jesus. And today, one of the things that's on my very heart is, especially with the different things that are happening all around us, is to think of that wonderful fact that Jesus is coming, and it could be today. And we're going to look at something of that and one or two other things that we've got today, not least, of course, my friend Nikki. Yes, and as you can see, I've got my home background on today because I've got one or two kind of new songs, new old songs. I know you like them, Nikki, and you can see everybody now, can't you? Yes. And you know, good morning, everybody. Hello, hi. And I've got a special friend with me today. Yeah, that's right. Because when it comes to summer, what I've been doing over the last few years is going to do missions in different countries. And one of the places I've gone to for many, many years is Russia. Yes, Russia. And it's so sad because of what is happening. I really miss my friends in Russia. So do I. But I've got Michaela. Yes, but he's got Michaela, who is his friend from Russia. And Nikki wanted us. Could we tell? Some of you may have seen this before, I don't know. The story of Michaela. Yes, okay. Well, we'll do that. Well, Michaela's coming in a few minutes. She's just getting prepared. And we're just getting her ready. And we'll come along and do Michaela. And then I've got some very interesting things for you. Mickey thinks so too, don't you? Yes, I do. Okay. Well, let's have a word of prayer first. Lord Jesus, we just thank you that you love us. We thank you that you're with us.
Yes, Jesus, thank you. You said you'll never leave us. Thank you.
Yes, Lord, thank you that you're with us. And each one of us, you're here and we can talk to you. We can cry out to you. We can ask you to help us to seek to follow you. And we do that, Lord. We pray you'll help us understand your word. And help us to do what you want us to do and turn away from the things that we know are wrong. We ask this, Lord Jesus, in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Well, I'm going to start off. And one of the reasons I've got my open screen on today is because I've got some songs here. They might be new. Some they might be old. And this is what they call the countdown song. Now, there's only one thing about it, which I don't, well, I like to sing songs that are true, that are true from the Bible and true that we know is going to happen. And of course, we know that Jesus is coming back. But this song sings as it starts, as you can see, is somewhere in outer space. Well, that's just a kind of a thought, because we see that Jesus, when he rose up into heaven and is coming down from heaven. Now, it's a bit beyond outer space. It's dimensionally not perhaps quite as accurate, this song in that sense. But we know Jesus is coming, and we know he went up in the clouds to heaven, and we know he's coming back in the clouds of heaven. But let's enjoy the song, because the truth is so good. Where it says, it goes like this. It goes, somewhere in outer space, God has prepared a place for those who trust him and obey. Jesus will come again, and though we don't know when, countdown's getting lower every day. 10 and 9, 8 and 7, 6 and 5 and 4, call upon the Savior while you may. 3 and 2, coming through the clouds in bright array. Countdown's getting lower every day. Do it again. Okay, you got it? Just sing it with us, okay? Somewhere in outer space, God has prepared a place for those who trust him and obey. Jesus will come again, and though we don't know when, countdown's getting lower every day. 10 and 9, 8 and 7, 6 and 5 and 4, call upon the Savior while you may. 3 and 2, coming through the clouds in bright array. Countdown's getting lower every day. The countdown's getting lower every day. This is what Jesus said. Jesus said, he says, and if I go and prepare a place for you, which is what Jesus says to his followers, he says, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. The Lord Jesus, for all of us, has a place in heaven. He's prepared it before the world began, because this world, as we call it, transitory. It's just a short period of time. Some people can live up to 100, but some people die when they're very, very young, even as babies. But Jesus has a place for us all, and he invites us to come to him, that he will, that wonderful day when he comes, or when it's our time for us to die, then he will can go to that incredible, unimaginable. I mean, it is, because I mean, the Bible said it is so fantastic. We're going to have a quick look at that a bit later on, as we do. But yeah, just before, is Michaela ready? Okay, right. Okay, well, let's just do. I've got another song. This is we sometimes say golden oldies. If you're a golden old, you might know this. If not, you may think this is a great brand new song. Well, it goes like this. It goes. Sing them over again to me, wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see, wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty, teach me faith and duty. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Christ the blessed, what gives to all, wonderful words of life. Sinner, listen to the loving call, wonderful words of life. All so freely given, wooing us to heaven. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Sweetly echo the gospel call, wonderful words of life. Offer pardon and peace to all, wonderful words of life. Jesus, only Savior, sanctifier forever. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Well, did you like that one? It's a, like we say, it's a golden oldie. And don't go away, because I've still got another golden oldie yet. And a bit more. But first of all, let's see, is Michaela coming? Nikki, where are you? Okay, is she here ready? Okay, well, this is, as we say this morning, this is Michaela's story. And, well, it started, I think it went to, what did they call the park? The Victory Park in Moscow, near there. We were out with a team of young people. And as we were there, as Mickey does whenever he goes anywhere, he wanders around, meets people. And Mickey, he was wandering around, and as he wandered around, he came across, there was a stall, and in that stall, there were, oh, she's trying to get them out. There was this monkey. Whoops, getting your hat right, Michaela. Okay. Oh, you're getting them out. Okay, sorry. We're getting all, oh, there she is. She's still fastened up. And this was Michaela. And Michaela, when Mickey looked at her, as you can see, she was all fastened up. You just managed to get out of your hands, haven't you? Yes, she did. We'd actually fastened her up, but anyway, she's managed to get her hands out. Well, she was all fastened up, and she was very, very sad. And And Mickey says, because he saw his, she was very sad, "What's the matter? What's the matter?" And Michaela says, "Well, nobody will buy me." She said, "Nobody will buy me." And, "Oh," Mickey said, "that's very, very sad, but I know someone who'll buy you."
"Nobody loves me," said Michaela. "Nobody loves me."
And she was so very sad. He really felt very, very sorry for her. So Mickey came, rushing up to me. And he says,
Mike, look, there's something I want you to do. Come with me."
I said, "Is it Mickey? I'm busy."
No, please come.
"Mickey, I'm busy." No. And he got hold of me tight. Guys are useful for some things, aren't they? He began to pull me. "I says, what are you doing, Mickey? Stop doing that." Yeah, and he just says, go. Okay, Mickey. And so I went with him, went down the park, and the other young people were all about the place. And he thought,
"Look, there's this lovely lady monkey. You must buy her."
"Mickey, can't buy her." I must admit, I felt sorry for her. She was looking very sad and kind of miserable. So I says to the lady behind the stall, I says, "How much for this monkey?" And she says something like, I don't know, what was it, Mickey? I know, I forget how much it was. It was in rubles, something like 1,000 or 2,000 rubles or something, which is the ruble of what they have in Russia for the currency. And something like about 20, 30 pounds or something. "Yes, I know it was, but that was very expensive for the monkey. And Mickey, really, we couldn't afford that. You know, it's very expensive coming to Russia and everything." I says, "No, I'm sorry, Mickey." And Mickey was very upset. And he says, no, please buy her. Please buy her, look, Mickey. And of course, she was so very, very sad. I says, "No, Mickey," I had to be firm. And I says, "No." And Mickey got very upset with me. And in fact, "Mickey, don't be rude. Now stop it, Mickey." Mickey became very rude. So I says, "No." And though Mickey was very sad. And of course, he says, "I'm so sorry." He says, "I'm so sorry to her." That's what he did anyway. But Mickey, well, monkeys sometimes get up to monkey business, don't they? That's what monkeys do. So what happened? We're walking around the park and I was just walking around. It was lovely. I mean, some places in Moscow are really nice. Well, on the way back, what Mickey had done, he'd gone to some of the other people on the team and he had said, come. And of course, he had taken them to see Michaela. And as I was walking back, the team called me over. They says, "Mike, come here. I says, what is it? And they pointed to Michaela and they says, "Look, you need to buy this lady. Look, she's so very, very sad." I says, "Mickey, you have been really naughty." And of course, the team were going on and Mickey was going on and this Michaela was kind of crying. Oh, dear. Okay. So I reached into my pocket. I got all my rubles out. And I says to the lady, "It's very expensive." Well, I had a translator because I can't speak Russian. And so the translator explained. She smiled. And I said, okay. And then she unfastened the rope. And Mickey came as well, and he got all the rope off her. She was all fastened up, and he tore the rope off her. And Michaela was, and Mickey says, "Michaela, you're free. Now you belong to us." And Michaela, oh, she was so excited. She came and started kissing me and kissing Mickey and going to kiss all everyone. Oh, she gives me now. That's right. Oh, I mean, everyone's so happy. And so we paid the price for her. Yes, we did. And do you know something? Well, and one of the reasons we'd like to tell you this story is because the Bible explains that before we become Christians, we're like all fastened up. Yes, we are. We are, you know, it's all like we can get the ropes around us, you know, we can chain ourselves up And the Bible says we belong to somebody. Yes, just like Michaela belonged to that lady and didn't treat her very nice. Not at all. The Bible explains that we belong to the evil one. That's right. The Bible says, because of things we've all done wrong, every one of us has done wrong, sinned. The Bible says we're under the control of this one here. Yeah. All have sinned. That means, and now I can have control. Yes. And he's known as the deceiver, the liar, the serpent. He's known as the devil. Of course, he came to the Garden of Eden in the form of a serpent. And he caused our first ancestor to sin, Adam and Eve. That's right, he did. And let's always remember, Jesus recognized Adam and Eve. And so it's not a fairy story. It is actually true. And remember, God's word is true. And Jesus spoke about it. The Apostle Paul, a very, very clever man in the Bible, he also spoke about the first man and woman. Yes, and of course, the devil doesn't want you to believe that. He wants you to think that maybe it came from some kind of prehistoric amoeba on the sea or something like this. God's word is true. And so anyway, the Bible explains that we are under his influence, should we say that. And he gets us to do wrong, and he helps us to disobey and to lie and all those awful things. Well, what happened was, the Bible tells us that we were all under his rule, that's right, but then Jesus came, and he came and he saw that we're all fastened up with these chains and ropes and under the control of the evil one, and he loved us. And so it was like this, and let's just do it in this way. I've got a picture here. This is Jesus, a picture of the Lord Jesus. And Jesus came and he says to the evil one, he said, oops, his gazer, come on, it's going away, come back again. Here he is. And Jesus said, now, I love these people who you put in chains and you cause them to do bad things. I want to take them off you and buy them, redeem them. How much? And it's like, the devil laughed and he said, you don't want to buy them. And let me tell you what they've done. They've lied, they've cheated, they've stolen, they've disobeyed families, they've done some terrible things. No, you don't want them. The Lord Jesus, oh yes, I do. I love them. I want to buy them from you and take them out of your power. How much? And the devil said, you can't buy these people. The price is too high, and you wouldn't want to pay the price for them. The Lord Jesus says, what is the price? You really want to know? Jesus says, tell me the price. Jesus, of course, knows. The devil said, it will be your life. You don't want to give your life for such as him or her or those people there. And the Lord Jesus says, oh, yes, I do. And I will. The devil was very angry, but he didn't realize that the power of love was greater than his hate and his evil. And so the Lord Jesus says, yes, I will give my life. I'll make you pay. And so in essence, that's really what happened. Because sin always requires punishment. When we do wrong, we break laws, there's always a consequence. A consequence of turning away from God, as we have as people in our land, is awful. And sin has what we call consequences. And so we see that Jesus, he was willing to take the punishment for the things you and I have done wrong. And so what happened? As we know, the Lord Jesus came and he was willing. And of course, this is true, of course. He was willing to die for us on the cross. And you see, when the devil saw that happen, he thought he'd won. He thought, well, that's right. He's given his life. He had no intention of letting us go. But the one thing he didn't understand, as he doesn't today. He doesn't understand the power of love, the power of forgiveness, and the power of God. And so the Bible explains, as we know, that Jesus, he rose from the dead. And on the third day, the Bible says he descended into hell. And you can imagine what it was like in hell, which is like the place, the Sheol. There would be the devil with all of his demons. They'd be celebrating. We've got him. We've got him now. We've defeated him. Oh, yes, they would be so happy and celebrating in their darkness because they had thought they had destroyed the Prince of Life. But no, we sometimes sing the song, Death Cannot Keep His Prey. Jesus, our Savior, he tore the bars away. And the Bible says he descended into hell. And there was the devil celebrating. And suddenly, in this horrendous gloom and light filled that dark place, suddenly the Lord Jesus appeared. And of course, suddenly the devil realized he had been defeated. And Jesus says, now you must let my people go. I'm lost again. And off he went. And Jesus, he came and he said, that's right. Jesus, he took off our sin. And now because he's alive, he's set us free. And as we'll hear later, Jesus says, come to me. And I give you this life. I give you forgiveness and joy. And I hope already you've experienced that. And so that's why we tell the story of Michaela. And the other story about Michaela, well, there is a bit more. And well, we'll do that later. We'll do that nice, Michaela, because it's really nice to have you with us here today with Mickey. And actually, the other part about this Michaela story is now Michaela, well, we brought her home because we adopted her. That's right. That's the other part of the story. We adopted her. And now she's part of our family. We asked her if she would like that. And she says, yes, we would. And so now she is family. She's like Mickey's sister. That's right. And they know they're brothers and sisters. Good friends. Have a fallout now and again. But really, they're okay. Is that right, Mickey?
Yes.
Okay, right. Well, we've got, as it's another song for us here today, which is from my book. And this is a song where, I'm going to hear about this in a minute, where Jesus wants us to make a stand for him. Stand up for Jesus. Jesus calls us to be bold, to be strong. We sometimes sing that song, but this morning we're doing one or two of these new songs about standing up for Jesus. It goes like this. Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory on to victory, his army he shall lead, till every foe is vanquished, and Christ is Lord indeed. Stand up for Jesus, stand in his strength alone. The armor flesh will fail you, you dare not trust your own. Put on the gospel armor, each piece put on with prayer. Let courage, where duty calls or danger, be never wanting there. Stand up for Jesus, the strife will not be long. This day the noise of battle, the next the victor's song. To him that overcometh, a crown of life shall be. He with the King of glory shall reign eternally. Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Put on the gospel, lift high his royal banner, it must not suffer loss. From victory on to victory, his army he shall lead, till every foe is vanquished, and Christ is Lord indeed. Okay. It's a golden oldie. Now, in a moment, we're going to go into our screen and go through some of these other clues that I want to share with you today about Jesus is coming. And there's just one other song I want to share with you about Jesus coming. And let me go into the screen. And hopefully you can see my screen now. And here it is. And whoops. This is the song, Jesus is Coming, which is to the tune, Chariots of Fire. Some of you may know this. It goes, Jesus is coming. He's coming soon. Jesus is coming. He's coming soon. It might be morning, noon, or night, when those who love him will take flight. Jesus is coming. He's coming soon. Take us to heaven, a wonderful day. He'll take us to heaven, a wonderful day. The glories of his majesty, we shall forever with him be. Jesus is coming, he's coming soon. Are you ready? Should it be today? Are you ready? Should it be today? When he comes in clouds of heaven, when the heavenly trumpet sounds, are you ready? It could be today. Should we do it again? Jesus is coming. He's coming soon. Jesus is coming. He's coming soon. It might be morning, noon, or night, when those who love him will take flight. Jesus is coming, he's coming soon. He'll take us to heaven, a wonderful day. He'll take us to heaven, no more a delay. The glories of his majesty, we shall forever with him be. Jesus is coming, he's coming soon. Are you ready? Should it be today? Are you ready? Should it be today? When he comes in clouds of heaven, when the heavenly trumpet sounds, are you ready? It could be today. And that's the wonderful thought, that indeed it could be. It could be today. And I'm going to show you just why it could be today as we go into our PowerPoint screen this morning. And we're just going to have a look at that now. So hopefully, let me make sure that you can see things. And here we go. And we're going to start from the beginning. Here it is. And Jesus talks. This is from where you can see, you can look this up yourself later on. These are the scriptures where Jesus speaks about these things that we're going to have a look at this morning. How Jesus talks about things that are going to happen. Now, many, many people are so curious about what is going to happen. People sometimes in the newspapers when I was growing up, my mother, who wasn't a Christian a long number of years, she used to consult horoscopes or read the stars, or people want to know the future. They go and consult astrologists and people like this just to find out what might happen. What's going to happen to me? Many, many people are so curious about the future. But the Bible tells us about the future, and it tells us what's going to happen. Now, of course, the followers of Jesus, they were curious too about things. And one of the things that the Jewish people were very, very proud of in Jesus' day was the temple. And they used to go into the temple to worship God And one day, as we were leaving the temple, some of Jesus' disciples were saying how this incredible temple had been built and all the stones and all the years it'd taken to make it and how fantastic it was. And Jesus said something very surprising. He said, "The time will come," and Jesus warned them, "when not one stone of this temple will be left on another. Every one of them will be thrown down." And it would appear that Jesus' followers were kind of shocked about this. How could that happen? Because even already they were beginning to think that Jesus was going to come and he was going to build his earthly kingdom. And so it must have been quite a shock to what they were saying, that the temple was going to be torn down. How could this be? And so they were curious about these things. And as Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives, which was opposite the temple, Peter, James, and John, and Andrew asked, "Tell us, when are all these going to happen? And what will be the signs that these things are going to take place? And what's going to happen to be at the end of the world?" So Jesus sat down and he began to explain to them some of the things that are going to happen prior to his return. And at that point, that they probably didn't realize exactly the meaning of what the Lord Jesus was saying. But the first thing that Jesus said was, "Don't be deceived." One of the problems today is the problem of what we call deception. In other words, trickery, not telling us the truth like it is the truth. That kind of started with the devil in the Garden of Eden. Remember how he tricked Eve to thinking God wouldn't punish them, how if they ate of the forbidden fruit, they would be like God. And Eve was tricked. She was deceived, the Bible says. Adam, he wasn't deceived. He knew fine well what was happening, but he still sinned. So Jesus speaks about, don't be tricked. Check things out. And this is very important. Even when people start quoting the Bible, it's good to see it, what they're saying is true about the Bible. Is it in its right place? Or are they just saying things? Remember, again, we know that the devil used the Bible to tempt Jesus. So Jesus says, this is very important. Don't be deceived, for many imposters will come in my name claiming to be Messiah. And you see, today, many people, can get deceived about all things. They think that if they do things like all these yoga or Middle Eastern practices, this will make them healthy and well. Well, they have spiritual roots. And when you look into them, it's not just a normal physical exercise. They have roots far beyond that. And it's good to check it out about what we're doing. Of course, it's very important to do exercises and to keep ourselves fit, absolutely. But what are we doing? Look into the background of yoga and some of the other things that people do practice. And of course, there are many other things that people do, and some of it seems all right, but it's, as we say here, the devil mixes in truth and lies to deceive and take people away from Jesus and the Bible. See, Jesus wants us to be separate from the things that the devil's involved in and just seek to keep ourselves clean and pure and not get involved, mix things. And of course, as we know, there are many, many other religions. But Jesus says, and we sometimes do it, we've got the song this morning, we might just do it if we have time. Now Jesus says, "I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No man can come to the Father but only through me." So one of the main things and the first thing that Jesus explained to them and says, don't be deceived. Check into things. Today we have lots of different news coming on. Is what the news saying is true? We think sometimes if the BBC says it, then it must be right. But then when you look at some other sources of information, we think, well, no, other things, that does not seem to be right. So it's very good to be learned to check. In fact, the Apostle Paul, when he was preaching the gospel at a place called Berea, the people from Berea thought, is what this man saying, is it true? So they checked the scriptures to find out. And God says, because they did that, they were honorable. And so it's a good thing to check things out. Don't just take things which we think are all right because our friends or we've always done that kind of thing. Important. Okay, now, Jesus speaks about this. He says, when you hear rumors of wars, don't be fearful. Because before he comes back again, Jesus explains that there will be wars, that nations will rise against nation and even kingdoms against kingdom. That means wars will be powerful. There's all the way through history, there have been wars because people have been falling out. There's jealousies. Where do wars come from? Jesus said, the Bible says, well, it's because of jealousy. People want what the other person's got, and greed and pride and selfishness. That's where wars come from. And of course, these things, the Bible says, are sin. And so sin produces these things. And sometimes if people get into positions of real power, then the war can be very traumatic and very sad. And of course, as we know, at this time that we have in this program, there is a very big war going on. And it's something that we're praying about and crying out to God that this war will stop. And of course, that's the war which is being experienced now in the Ukraine. And the Lord Jesus, he says that these wars will happen. And here's a couple of pictures which are taken from the war in Ukraine, actually, which is going on even as we speak. And it's an awful thing with all these people who are losing their homes and many losing lives. It is just an absolute tragedy as this war is ongoing, and how we ask and pray that this war may suddenly stop. And of course, this is the reason why I will not be able to go to Russia at the moment unless this war stops, and we hope it will. And so Jesus began to explain there will be wars and rumors of wars, but he says, but don't be fearful, don't be fearful. He says there will be great earthquakes, there will be famines in many lands and epidemics. And of course, as we just know, we're coming just out of the awful epidemic of the COVID, which has for the last 2 years been around and done much illness and deaths, and so many problems have happened because of COVID. And over the history, there has been many, many plagues and many illnesses, as we say, epidemics and other things happening. And earthquakes, you see, and here, for instance, this is a picture of the earthquake that happened in Haiti. I've actually been there and seen the effects of an earthquake. And here in the United Kingdom, we don't get many earthquakes, but if you went on Google, which I did last night, and you check out earthquakes, you will find that even here in the United Kingdom, earthquakes are going on all the time. They're very small, the 1 and 2 on the Richter scale. But earthquakes are happening all the time. Every day there's earthquakes because of the movement of the earth. But then sometimes when they become big, like we call it, the Richter scale of 7 or 8, oh my, then awful things happen as the earth moves. And this was one of them here in Haiti. There was a terrible earthquake there and in many other places. And I've actually been in Mexico when there was an earthquake, and just being in the earthquake, it was like you're on a ship and you're going up and down. It was really quite something being actually in an earthquake. And it's very scary too, of course, it is. And so let's have a look. Famines. Oh, again, this, I could show you lots and lots of pictures, and there are famines going on even as we speak in Somalia and other places where there's been drought. And this is what happens to the ground when it just, there's no rain, it cracks up. And in certain places now, this is how it is happening. There are famines. And in other places, there are floods. In America, in the place called Yellowstone Park, you may have seen it on the news, there's been incredible rain, incredible floods. Bangladesh at the moment is having incredible rain and incredible floods. And all these things are happening. And Jesus says they will happen. And prior to his return, it's going to increase. Now we speak about what they call climate change. But Jesus said that this was going to happen. And it's really because of our selfishness and of our greed. That's why these things are happening. And if we turn to the Lord and we seek to help each other and use the resources, for instance, here in Edinburgh used to be known as Old Ricky. In fact, we used to have smoke and the whole became great fogs and everything else. And then when they stopped the smoke from the coal fires in Edinburgh, because all being surrounded by hills, all the smoke used to sink down and it was really quite difficult. Then the atmosphere cleared. But then it was just a very practical help. It didn't become extreme because outside of Edinburgh, people still use the coal fires and everything. So there is a balance, and we're not to be overly concerned about these things. Now, Jesus said also, he says, there'll all be these things, famines, and there'll be floods and different things. But then Jesus spoke to them and says, you are going to be handed over to be persecuted, and you'll be hated because of me. Many will turn away from the faith. They will betray and hate each other. The love of many will grow cold, but the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. Now, Jesus and the Bible tells us that it's hard to really follow Jesus. Jesus speaks about taking up the cross. Yes, it's great when everyone around us is becoming a Christian and we're all enjoying God's presence and enjoying fellowship and church and singing. And that is great. But sometimes it works the other way. Many people in some countries, if they become a Christian, they will be persecuted. They will be taken away from their families. Sometimes they will even be killed when they say that Jesus is the Lord of their life. And that is happening in many countries. In fact, I don't know if I've got time to show you today, but I was looking at a thing, a program called Open Doors. Because of copyright issues, I thought I'll not show it you just now, but I'll maybe put it on my page if you want to see that, Open Doors. And you see all the different countries of the world where there is open persecution. The chief of the countries that persecute people at the moment is Afghanistan. Yes, Afghanistan, where Christians there are beaten up and killed and hunted. And so they have to flee and escape. And of course, because of the conflict that happened in Afghanistan, and when the Americans and the West left and gave Afghanistan over to the Taliban, who were saying, oh, we're going to be nice and good, are now persecuting and killing Christians and other people of other faiths too that don't belong to their religion. So it's really, really hard and to make a stand for Jesus. And again, Jesus carries on by saying, they will put you in prison. You will be brought before kings and governors, all account of my name. And of course, this is what happened in the early church. Just when, after the Holy Spirit had come upon the believers and there were many wonderful things happening, miracles and many people becoming Christians, there was also the persecution. And just to show you this, that's right. And Jesus said, don't worry how you will defend yourself. I will give you words and wisdom that none of you. So don't worry how you'll defend yourself. I'll give you words and wisdom that none of your enemies will be able to resist or contradict. And remember this wonderful promise that Jesus says he will never leave us. And as an example of that, we have in the Bible, we have Stephen. Now, Stephen he was doing wonderful things and miracles, and he just loved the Lord Jesus so much, and he was telling people about Jesus. And when we read in the story in Acts, and we've got a bit of the quote there in Acts chapter 7, and he began to explain to these religious leaders how they were the real ones responsible for what had happened to Jesus, and how they and their ancestors continually he had spoken against God, and they weren't following God. They said that they followed God with their lips, but their hearts were far from him, which is what the Lord Jesus says to them as well. These were the religious leaders of Jesus's day. And so Stephen explained the truth to them, that to some degree, they were what we call hypocrites. They pretended to be something they weren't, supposed to lead people to God, and yet they were doing exactly the opposite. So when Stephen says this to them, it says that the Jewish leaders were infuriated by what Stephen said, and they shook their fists at him in rage. But Stephen, being full of the Holy Spirit, he gazed steadfastly into heaven, and he saw the glory of God, and he saw Jesus standing in the place of honor at God's right hand. And he told them, I'm seeing this. I'm seeing the heavens opened, and the Son of Man standing in the place of honor at God's right hand. Well, they were so furious. They were so angry. And they put their hands over their ears and began shouting at him. They rushed at him. They dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. His accusers took off their coats and laid them at the feet of a young man named Saul, and they stoned him. And as they were stoning Stephen, again, God's love was in Stephen's heart. He knew he was going to heaven. He knew his sins were forgiven. And so he prayed and he says, Lord, and he also prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And then as he fell to his knees, as they were stoning him, he says, Lord, don't charge them with this sin. And then he died. And so as that was happening, and you see, the Bible says even tragedies can work for good when we believe God. It says Saul was one of the witnesses, and he agreed completely with the killing of Stephen. And so then a great wave of persecution began that day, sweeping over the church in Jerusalem, and all the believers were scattered through the regions of Judea and Samaria. And it seemed an absolute tragedy what was happening. But Saul had seen the witness of Stephen, how in the midst of dying and persecution, he still loved the Lord, and he didn't blaspheme or shout or curse at those who were doing things like this. In fact, it was the love of God that was upon Stephen's face as he went up to heaven. So Saul, after that, he thought, these Christians, I've got to get rid of them. I've got to get rid of them. So he got letters from the priests, the religious leaders again, to persecute the Christians. And he was on his way to Damascus. And you know, lots of Christians would be praying for him. Lots of people would be praying, oh, Lord, please stop Saul for what he's doing. Lord, would you please maybe remove him? Others were perhaps praying this prayer, which is a great prayer to pray. They were saying, Lord, please, you can change lives. You've changed our lives. Would you change the life of Saul? Would you show and reveal yourself to him? And maybe some were praying that. That's a good prayer to pray, especially for our leaders, those in authority, to pray that the Lord Jesus will show them that he is the way, the truth, and the life. Well, the Bible tells us, as Paul or Saul, as he came near Damascus, a light shone around him from heaven. And he fell to the ground, and he heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he said, who are you, Lord? And when this word Lord means, who are you? Because this must be God. You must be God. And the Lord said, I am Jesus. And when you read the words, I am, again, it's the name for God. So we know Jesus is God. And the Lord said, I am Jesus whom you are persecuted. It is hard for you to pick against the goads. In other words, Saul had seen the way that Stephen had died. He could see that Stephen had got something that he hadn't got, but he didn't want to admit it. He did not want to admit that he was wrong. And this is the problem today. So many people don't want to admit or find it very, very hard to admit that they are wrong. There's something inside us. We don't want to say sorry or, yes, I've done wrong. Sometimes one of the hardest things to do, we make excuses for our sin. That's right. We say it's the way I'm made. Oh, and so we deny the truth of God's word with our excuses. But you can't make excuses before God, because every one of us has to give an account of our life to him. So Saul was changed. And so everyone was amazed. Because then, as we see, Saul, whose name became Paul, who had been a murderer, and as he said himself, one who blasphemed God, was suddenly changed by God's power. God can change the hardest ones. And I want to say hallelujah to that. He does. He changes us. And he cleanses us from all of our sin. He takes away any guilt, any condemnation. He gives us a new life. And that's what happened to Saul. He became Paul. And everyone was amazed because instead of persecuting the Christians and beating them up, he became one and he helped many hundreds, even thousands and tens of thousands and millions over the years because of his writings, which he wrote while he was in prison. Just amazing how God turned things around. So what appeared to be a tragedy worked out for good. And we see God doing that many times in the Bible. Well, so Jesus says, important, he says, stand firm. This gospel will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all the nations, and then the end will come. You see, Jesus wants everyone to hear about him. We sometimes are saying, Lord, how long before you come? Well, we know he could come at any time, but we know also he's not willing that anybody should perish, for that everybody should come to know him as their Lord and Savior. And that's what Jesus desires for all of us. And so I hesitate sometimes because I'm... That's right. Now, Jesus explains a little bit more about the time of his coming. And he says, when you see Jerusalem being surrounded by armies, you'll know that the time there is destruction has arrived. If you are in Jerusalem, try to escape to the mountains, and those outside the city must not attempt to return. Now, Jesus, when he's speaking about what's going to come in the future, we sometimes say there is a partial fulfillment in the time of Jesus, but there's also another fulfillment to come. It's like when you look at a mountain, if you look from a distance at a mountain through a telescope, you can kind of see two peaks maybe. And it's almost like from a distance, they're close together. But as you get closer, they're actually quite a long way apart. And what Jesus was saying here, and he was warning the people, because not long after he had died, there was going to be a terrible persecution. And in that time, it says it's going to be very dreadful for pregnant women and nursing mothers because they were going to have to flee. Jesus told them about what would be happening to Jerusalem, how the Roman armies were going to come. They were going to surround it. There was going to be a terrible siege. And there's going to be great distress in the land and wrath upon the people. And then the Jewish people were going to be killed and sent away as exiles and captives to all nations of the world. And as we said, and as we know the history, as we look at what Jesus was talking about then, we see how this was fulfilled in AD 70 when the Romans were completely destroyed. The Romans completely destroyed Jerusalem and the Jewish survivors were forced into exile. Here's a picture of that. August the 4th, 70 AD. And this was under a Roman general called Titus, from his father Vespasian, who was the emperor, and it was a terrible time. They say that nearly 1 million people died in that siege. It was a terrible time, but Jesus warned them. So if they heeded Jesus's warning, lots of them would have escaped because Jesus said this was going to happen and they were to flee at that time. Now, Jesus was speaking of another fulfillment. See, the Jewish people were going to be scattered over all the earth. Now, some people think, and I do too, that when Jesus gives this illustration of the fig tree, he's really referring to the nation and also the nations round about Israel. And Jesus says, look at the fig tree or any other tree. When the leaves come out, you know that summer is near. In the same way, when you see these events taking place, you can be sure that the kingdom of God is near and the end of this age has come. Heaven and earth may pass away, but my words will never pass away. And so Jesus was speaking about the Jewish people going to be scattered and the gospel was going to come onto the Gentiles. But then towards the end, prior to Jesus' return, he was speaking that Israel, the Jewish nation, was going to be restored. And we have seen that this has happened. See, Jesus said here that Jerusalem will be trampled on by the Gentiles, which is like non-Jews. If you're not a Jewish person, then you're a Gentile. I'm a Gentile. And it says, until the times the Gentiles has come to an end. Well, we are seeing now this beginning to happen. Because for instance, in the year 1948, and this is the newspaper cutting of the day, that Israel, the Jewish state, after these 2,000 of years, the Jewish state was born. And this is a sign, a great sign, because it fulfills God's promise of bringing back the Jewish people into their own land. And once again, Israel is now established. As yet, Israel don't know Jesus as their savior. But the fulfillment of God's word, as Jesus says, heaven and earth will pass away. But what he says will happen, as you can see, this was the birth of Israel in 1948. And Jesus says these words. He says, this generation that sees the rebirth of Israel will see all these things I am speaking about being fulfilled. Now, it could mean Jerusalem. It became under Jewish control in 1967 when Jerusalem was taken over in that 1967 war. And even just about four years ago, in 2017, Jerusalem was made by Donald Trump and some other countries the capital, the undivided capital of Israel. Now, that's caused a little bit of controversy, some of you will be aware, but it is also a sign from Scripture that the coming of Jesus is close. And then Jesus speaks about there'll be signs in the sun, moon and stars. The sun will be darkened, moon not give a light, stars will fall. And it can be speaking about meteorites and other things that are coming from heaven. But very quickly, just go on. It says nations will be in anguish, perplexity, the roaring and tossing of the sea. People will faint from terror, apprehensive of what is coming on. And more we begin to see all these things increasing in our day. And then when these things happen, then Jesus says, the peoples of the earth will see me, the Messiah, coming in a cloud of power with great glory. So when all these things begin to happen, stand straight up and look, for your salvation is near. And Jesus is saying, don't let your heart be troubled. And soon, very soon, we shall see the King, and Jesus will come in his power and his glory, which is just such an exciting prospect to look forward to. So Jesus warns, he says, watch out. Don't let my sudden coming catch you unawares. Don't let me find you living in careless ease, drinking and worried and totally occupied with the problems of this life like everyone else. He is a Christian. We to put first the kingdom of God. And Jesus says, everything that we have need, if we put him first, he will look after us. And Jesus concluded, he says, watch and pray that you'll be able to escape all that is to happen and that you may be able to stand before the Son of Man. So when Jesus, as we know, had told the disciples these things and he had died and risen again, and it was time for him to go into heaven, And as he was there finally with the disciples, they were said, Lord, is this now the time come for you to free Israel and restore your kingdom? And Jesus replied, the Father alone has the authority to set those dates and times. They're not for you to know. But he told them they would receive power when the Holy Spirit would come upon them. And they would be his witnesses, telling people about him everywhere, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. And then we read, as he was saying these things, he was taken as a cloud while they were watching. They could no longer see him. And as they were looking into heaven, there was two white-robed men or angels stood among them. And he said, men of Galilee, they said, why are you standing here, staying in heaven? Jesus has been taken from you into heaven, but someday will return to heaven in the way they saw him go. And then, in that time which is coming, and which we're looking forward to, John, in the book of Revelation, he sees it. He says, I saw a new heaven and new earth. But the old heaven and the old earth had disappeared, and the sea was also gone. And I saw the holy city, the New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of a heaven like a bride dressed for her husband. And I heard a shout from the throne saying, look, God's home is now amongst his people. He will live with them and they will be his people. God will wipe every tear from their eyes. There's no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. All these things are gone forever. And Jesus makes all things new. And you can see some of the glory that is going to come in the not too distant future. And it's been ready for it. And it says all that were victorious will inherit all these blessings. But there is a consequence for those who refuse. And so as we conclude today, and of course there was such a lot, I know there's a lot in that story today. I've done it very quickly. But finally, Jesus says, here I am. I stand at the door and I knock. This is the time of salvation. It's the time where we have this opportunity to receive Christ as our Savior. And Jesus says, if anyone, that's you, will hear my voice and open the door, I will come in. And remember that, yes, this verse applies to those people who are not a Christian. If you're not a Christian, this is what Jesus is asking you to do. But he's actually saying these words to Christians. And if you're a Christian and you've been, as it were, wasting your time, not been doing what Jesus wants you to do, is not first in your life, even today, as we talk to him, as he's here with us, as we just conclude our program this morning, why don't you, if you've never done this, or if you've not been following Jesus as you know you should, just ask him afresh today and just say to him, Lord, here I am. I hear you speaking to me. I know, Lord, there's a work you have for me to do. Lord, so I hear your voice and I open the door. Please come and fill me. And fill me with your Holy Spirit. Can you pray that today, just as we finish? Let's pray together anyway. And if you want to, you can say this prayer with me. So, Lord Jesus, thank you. You're coming back again. Help me, Lord Jesus, to serve you and to follow you and do what you want me to do. So thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, like I say, our time has gone quite quickly. Lots of other different things, but we'll do some more next week. So thanks for looking in, and may the Lord bless you, and may you have a great week. And I'll be back through the week, the midnight hours, normally do, and hope to see some of you then. Bye for now. Bye. God bless.